Okay, so let's continue our study about wind energy. And this is a series of videos, and this is like, I believe, the second video in the series. So this is part two on wind energy. And already in part one, we had seen introduction to wind energy and all. And here we'll briefly look at economics of wind energy. Actually, this is basically incomplete. Much more on the subject of economics of wind energy, much more can be done. And then I'm just making a very, very short video from whatever basic information that is available online. So let's go through it. And later on, maybe in future, when I study this subject even more, I'll try to add more videos on it. So this is just a very incomplete basics of economics of wind energy. So first is wind power has reached grid parity around the world during this period. So this is 2005 to 2015. So over the past decade or so, slowly different regions of the world, the grid parity has been reached. So what is the meaning of grid parity? So grid parity means the cost of wind energy has become comparable to cost of the mainstream energy, which is like the coal power or diesel power, whatever. So whatever is the main sources of energy, and now the wind power is reaching that. Parity means equality. So the grid parity it has reached. That means now it's a time for switching over from fossil fuels to wind energy because grid parity has been reached. Otherwise, if the renewable energy is more costlier compared to the existing energy, so economically it didn't make sense, but now it is. Wind, and that is what is being observed around the world because the demand is also increasing and the renewable energy is also increasing very significantly, not even able to catch up the demand, but that is the reason why fossil fuel slightly it is increasing, but then eventually the renewable energy will overtake the other forms of energy. Look at this. Wind power is capital intensive but has no fuel cost. So of course, so once you have the wind turbine, so this is a wind turbine, and then it is once you have constructed this, literally it is just very minimal maintenance, almost nothing. Whenever wind blows, this turbine will automatically turn towards that wind and start extracting power from that wind, and then the current will come through your electrical wires and it flows to the grid. So there's absolutely no fuel you are burning, no water is being used, no need to give any water or any oil or anything like that. It just runs and it generates clean energy without any emission of gases or whatever. So all that things we have seen. So but the problem is this itself, where does it come from? So for this it is a capital intensive. Price of wind power is more stable compared to the fossil fuels based power because the cost of wind is anyway not there, so therefore the price of the wind power can be stable, whereas the cost of fossil fuels varies. Like sometimes it is $100 a barrel, sometimes it is $40 a barrel, and sometimes it is $180 a barrel. So the fuel prices, as they change, the power coming from fossil fuels also change the cost of that. But anyway, the price of wind power is more stable. That's what is the meaning. Marginal cost of wind power is very, very low at 1 cent per kilowatt hour. So it's almost negligible, just 1 cent per kilowatt hour. So what is the meaning of marginal cost? Marginal cost is, let's say you are already generating a power of 100 kilowatts. How much it will cost to generate 101 kilowatt? So that additional 101th kilowatt, what is the cost of that particular kilowatt? So typically that is very low. It is like 1 cent per kilowatt hour, quite low. Average cost is more, as it will include the cost of construction of wind turbine, also transmission system. So although marginal cost is less, the average cost will also kind of consider the fixed cost, so it is more. Now, factors affecting cost per unit of wind power. So wind speed. Now, let's say you have made the investment and then the tower is standing. So the investment is made. Now, due to some reason, what if wind doesn't come? So what if there is no wind? So then this investment becomes a waste. But what if there is a wind? So some wind is there. So then, depending on amount of wind, your investment will start making sense or not. So it is, in a way, it is like betting. So it is like gambling. So you imagine that a certain city somewhere at this place, I'll set up a wind tower, and then I'll hope that the wind is going to come there. So at 7 meters per second, 8 meters per second, or 10 meters per second, whatever. So wind, the more wind comes, I make more money. So it is like gambling. But then there are forecasting, there is data collection, there are history, everything. So it is not as bad and worse as gambling. It is, there could be a very proper way to go about it. And then, in fact, it is, the odds are not against you. The odds are in favor of you. Even though it is gambling, you can odds are in favor, you can make money. So also turbine, so that is about wind speed. So this, the more wind speed is there, the less cost per unit. Turbine design and construction, yes. Rated capacity of the turbine. See, sometimes what happens, the rated capacity of the turbine, so this is a turbine. Let's say rated capacity is 1 megawatt. And due to our luck, 15 meters per second wind is blowing. Heavy wind is blowing. But then, even though the wind is blowing more, so see, there is a mechanical energy, and then there is a electrical energy conversion. And of course, there is a kinetic energy. So kinetic energy in the wind is converted to mechanical energy in the turbine, which is in turn converted to electrical energy. Now let's say kinetic energy available is close to 2 megawatt, but then the mechanical system itself is designed for 1 megawatt, and the electrical system also designed to handle only 1 megawatt. So if I push 2 megawatts into this, it will damage the blades will break, even the tower might even crack and everything. So under such conditions, you will not attempt to convert the entire power. You will choose this one. So otherwise, what you have to do, if you are expecting 2 megawatts of kinetic energy, you can actually take a higher rated capacity. That will again increase the investment cost and all. So many things are interrelated. So rated capacity of the turbine also plays a role in cost per unit. Exact location improve. So even like you see, there is a, I'll draw a smaller figure here. There's a mountain here. So on this side of the mountain, you have a wind turbine. On the other side of the mountain also, there's a wind turbine. So obviously, both will not be able to generate at the same time, because if the wind is from this side, the wind will hit the turbine, wind will hit this one, and then it goes into the wind will go higher, and it forms clouds, and then, you know, the clouds will go to the other side or this side, whatever. So there is no wind here, so there is not much power generated here. Or the contrary can happen. What can happen, the wind is on this side, so therefore this wind tower generates a lot of power, and then the wind hits the mountain and wind diverted upwards and then forms clouds, and the clouds will go here and rain. So of course this turbine cannot generate power from rain. So therefore, if there is a mountain and you construct towers on both sides, it is not a good investment. Either you will face losses here or you will face losses here, depending on the wind direction. So of course, if this is the edge of the island and this is land and this is ocean, so definitely this is going to make losses. So, exact location is important. Improvements in turbine design and whatever is the capital and all. Now, look at this couple of statements. Assuming the same size project, higher the wind speed, lower will be the per unit cost of generation. And assuming the same wind speed, larger wind plant will be more economical. So, this also we had seen. So, sometime back we were looking at this particular thing. So higher capacity will be more economical compared to smaller capacity. So this tower is generating 10 megawatts, but whereas you want to generate 10 megawatt here, 0.5 megawatt, so you require 20 towers, this one, which is going to be more costly and all. So these are some basic assumptions, basic first level incomplete view of economics of wind. Now, slightly, let us go into a little bit of detail. So, we found a presentation at this link. It has some information like this. Typical distribution of cost of wind plant. So, what are the parts in the wind plant? So, we have the tower. We have this, that nacelle. We have the hub. And we have the blades. Something like this. So what is the cost of the thing? The 65% is the turbine cost, 12% is the construction cost, 8% is the electrical parts, 5% is the grid connection, and remaining 10% is the project management and financial cost and, you know, salaries and things like that. So many other things. So this is the general distribution of the cost. So where you, for wind, to reduce the cost, where you find the maximum impact, it is in the mechanical design of the turbine itself. So by efficiently designing these turbine blades, by choosing proper materials for turbine blades and everything, you can actually impact the cost. And that is what is happening in this diagram, you see. 1990, 1995, 2000. So as we keep going into the future, we are able to, using better manufacturing, using better computers and using better simulation tools and modeling and all, we are able to generate a more larger and larger capacity wind turbines. And also, of course, behind all this, this one, there is also investment needs to come. So as the public confidence increases on wind energy, more and more people and more governments are coming forward to invest in wind energy. So therefore, newer technologies are going to develop. In fact, this is incomplete actually. By 2020, we will also have a 20 megawatt wind turbine. So this is 10 megawatt, but then there will be even more efficient 20 megawatt single turbine. And again, you can imagine the size of it. All right, let's continue. So typical cost. So 51 megawatt is a wind farm. Wind speed about 68 meters per second. And the capital cost is $65 million or $1,300 per megawatt. Actually, this is not matching with this. So if I take 1,300 and multiply by 51, so I'm not getting this 65 million. But then I think this is plus 1,000 or into 1,000. So that's it. And then annual production is 150 million kilowatt hour. We can actually verify this. So what they are claiming is, if you have a 51 megawatt size, then your annual production is 150 million. So let's quickly calculate the capacity factor. Actual generation is 150 million kilowatt hour. So 150 million means 10 to the power of 6 kilowatt hour. This is the actual in the numerator. In the denominator, you have 51 megawatt. So 51 into 10 power 3 kilowatts into, in 1 year, you have 8760 hours. So kilowatt hours cancel out, and through this I can calculate the capacity factor. So this 10 to the power of 3 will become 10 to the power of 3 here. I have, okay, so let me, 150 is in the numerator, 1000 is in the numerator, 51 is in the denominator, and then 8760. So about 33.5%. So capacity factor considered is 33.5%. So in this particular analysis. So we can actually cross-check things like that. So whenever you see a bunch of data like this, it's nice to do this kind of calculation so that it will be good. Now electricity cost. 3.6 to 4.5 cents. So this is actually the cost that you are getting from the grid power, because you have to see the cost. So what is the, if I multiply these two, annual production 150 million. So 150 million kilowatt hour per year multiplied by, okay, let's take 4 cents. So 4 into 150. So 150 into 4, this will be in cents. So if I divide by 100, so I'll get in dollars. So I'm getting 6. So I'm getting $6 million. So what is this $6 million? This is the cost of the power that is or the value of the power that is being generated. And $6 million, if your total cost is 65 million, so actually if I multiply with I think 11 years, so it will be $66 million. So actually the payback period could be as low as 11 years. Of course, the choice of, like, I made 4 cents, so that also makes a difference. So it is, it need not be 20 years, it could be as low as 11 years itself, based on this calculation. So this is how you do some basic calculations. Of course, I am not showing you a proper structured economical cost-benefit analysis of the wind. I'll mention that towards the end here later. So this is another small topic, that is small scale wind power. So typical size is below 50 kilowatt. Alternative diesel generation in remote areas. Anyway, now let's come to this concept of energy conversion. So what is happening here is the kinetic energy of the wind is converted to mechanical energy. So in 1919, German physicist Albert Betz showed that ideal wind energy extraction machine can only extract 59.3% of kinetic energy of the wind. So he had a German physicist has shown through proper mathematics that a wind energy system cannot extract more than 53%, or it can this is the maximum possible thing. Thus 59.3 is called a Betz limit. Now when I read this for the first time, like some 16 by 27, 16 looks like 4 square and 27 is 3 cube and something like that. So it's quite mathematical actually. So I got very excited. I was trying to learn what is the mathematics that this 1919 German physicist Albert Betz, what is kind of mathematics he has done to find out, you know, what is this. And lo and behold, I was able to find some things and I was material and I was able to do that mathematics, and it was very, very interesting. In fact, I'm going to do a video on that. Maybe the next video will be that, mathematics of wind energy conversion. In that we will see this Betz limit. So it's very interesting. And this Betz limit is considering this is the keyword here, ideal wind energy extraction machine. But what about practical wind energy extraction machine? So modern practical wind turbines are able to reach 70-80% of the Betz limit. So this is another thing. So these all things come into picture when you're actually sitting down trying to design the wind energy system. So, and I hope people who are seeing this video, you know, some of you might actually end up in designing this wind turbines and all, or maybe some of you are already in that designing business, and you know, and you might identify with what I'm saying. Maybe I'm saying something wrong. So if that is the case, you are the expert on this topic, I'd love to get some feedback on that. I'm just trying to share, you know, my excitement when I learned this subject. All right, so design considerations: aerodynamics, deflection of air by turbine, blade shape and dimensions, strength to resist forces on the blade, and design of the whole wind energy conversion system, turbine design, all these things will come into picture. So we'll come to this further information part. Just one thing I would like to talk about, that is pitch control. And another thing is something like this. So this is an interesting curve. But what exactly is this curve? So on x-axis, we have wind velocity. So let's say and on y-axis is the power output of the turbine. So since we had learnt per unit system, So let's call it as 1 per unit. That means the rating of the turbine itself is 1 per unit. So it cannot over generate, because that will overheat the transformer, or that will overheat the generator and it will damage mechanically. So this is my rated capacity. So maybe my 1 per unit refers to 50 megawatts of power, so something like that. Now on the x-axis I have wind velocity, so this may be 4 meters per second, this may be 8 meters per second, this may be 12 meters per second. Why am I writing meters per second every time? This is wind velocity in meters per second. So this may be 15, this may be 18, this may be 21. Now what is happening is, we all know that this is the nothing but function of V cube. So as the cube of velocity, the power starts increasing. So at this point, let's say I'm generating 0.05 per unit. So this point, let us call this cut-in velocity. And let's call this as the rated velocity, or like its normal operation. And this one is called cutout velocity. So what is happening is, this pitch control is the important thing. See, as the wind velocity is increasing, your machine is not overloaded. Therefore, as the wind velocity is increasing, your output is also increasing. So that means from 4 to 8, it will become 3 times more. Sorry, it will become 8 times more power. So because the velocity is doubling, the output will become 8 times more. The function of cube. So like that, huge increase is going on here. So at 12, what is happening? Why am I not able to generate more is because I'm hitting the generation limits. So if you're hitting the generation limits, then what is happening? So this is kinetic energy of the wind. Then you have the wind turbine itself like this. Then you have some gears. And then you have the generator. So now, if the kinetic energy is very high, so something like 2 megawatts, so how much is the mechanical conversion? So what is the mechanical energy? So it could be, I'm sorry, so here I mentioned 50 megawatts. So let's say the kinetic energy you are receiving is 80 megawatts. So 30 megawatts you release it outside. The remaining 50 megawatts only you let it enter into this one. So of course, if you are getting less, you can actually divert more. But then after this point, what you do is, by using pitch control, you are not capturing entire power from the wind. You are leaving out some of the energy, so that you are protecting the generator from getting overloaded. So this is electrical energy conversion. So this point, so therefore why it is flat is, more power is available, but I am not able to generate because of my limited capacity. So that is the meaning of this. So anyway, so this, I wanted to talk about this pitch control and this curve. Cut-in speed, cut-out speed and all these things. Anyway, so further information, you can go to this website. Global Wind Energy Council. So let me see if that page is open. So gwec.net. So you can go here and then you can see some interesting things. I think it's still loading. So since we are trying to understand what is the global scenario of wind energy and all, so you can actually look at this, and there's some news and updates and all these things. So Global Wind Energy Council is the international trade association for wind power industry. Mission is to ensure wind power establishes itself as the answer to today's energy challenges, substantial environmental economic benefits. So these are some of the things. So wind energy FAQ. So let me, this is also, I'm first time I'm opening this. So download our new global wind energy fact sheet. Interesting. So this I did not see before. So I'm directly opening in front of you. So let's see what's there in it. Some of this might be already known to us. So let's zoom. I think my browser is creating some problem. All right, so since I'm getting stuck here, I'll not waste your time more. So I ask you to go to this Wind Energy Council website and then try to explore, you know, make your own notes like this. See, the basically the exercise which I have done is very, very simple. I've just explored online and, you know, searched some websites and prepared some notes, and then just the same notes I'm sharing with you. And just to give you an overall, it's like telling like a story. What is going on with the wind energy. So here it is. In the next video, I'd like to really take up what I found, you know, very interesting, and what I learned a lot today, that is mathematics behind wind energy conversion. So it's going to be a little bit mathematical. So let's meet in that next video.